your presence. Burn my soul with the goodness of your grace. Burn my soul with the glory of your presence. Burn my soul with the goodness of your grace. Oh, your grace, oh Lord, a great, great your presence. You flood my soul with the goodness of your grace. You flood my soul with the glory of your presence. You flood my soul with the goodness of your grace. Of your grace, you flood my soul with the glory of your presence. You flood my soul with the glory of your grace.
Lord Jesus, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we worship you. We worship you. We worship you, Almighty God. With floods of emotion, with floods of joy, with floods, oh God, of your glorious praise and thanksgiving. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Blessed is the name, blessed is the name of the Lord. All praise unto the name. All praise unto the name of the Lord. Lord Jesus, our Savior forever. Lord Jesus, our glorious great high priest. You know, when if you don't know the words when I'm singing, you can just go, you can just sing in the spirit. It'll carry a melody with it, actually. If you've got a melody, it'll carry a melody. And if you don't have a melody, it'll bring in one. One time a person said, how do you find the harmonies? That's how I find it. Somebody told me, he said, how do you do those words when you're just writing a song? Just spontaneously. That's how I do it. It produces words. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Just enjoy His presence for a little bit. Let me see what you do in your living room at home. Let me help you, because maybe you're not getting in past your ceiling. Hallelujah. Let's help you. Let us help you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, you know, it just, the presence of the Lord is, the presence of the Lord is just wonderful. You just have to relax. Some people try too hard. Trying hard is doubt. Relaxing in confidence is faith. Hallelujah. Saying what's wrong with me is worse kind of doubt. Huh? Thanking Father that for all that He is to us, that's faith. Hallelujah. We're just here. We're here to train you how to live in the Word and walk in the Holy Ghost. And the bottom line of it is, if you don't know the Word of God, you're never going to live in it. And that's why you'll see me as a pastor from a pastoral role. I'm always really interested to see if people know enough about the Word of God to be able to pray it. Because I listen to people pray. I pay attention. I'm not checked out. I listen. I watch what people say when they sing. I watch what people do when they pray. I watch what people do when they're listening to the Word. Why? Because we want to help you. God needs laborers. And the kind of laborers that Father wants are those that know how to flow and function and operate in the Holy Ghost. You can be seated. We're going to just, I know you guys worship about 2 hours on Sunday night. It's good to have every one of you here. It's good that you're here, because I'm telling you right now, Father has made us fit for heaven by the wonderful work of salvation that took place at Calvary's cross. And it wasn't just 2,000 years ago. It's something that is effective for us right at this very moment. Father has given us every ability and every skill that we need to be able to walk in heaven, live in heaven. He sent the Holy Ghost about 2,000 years ago, and not just 2,000 years ago. He's here right now. And it's an urgent thing for me to get people functioning in the Word of God. And give people function in the realms of the Holy Ghost. And so that's the only reason I preach. I don't preach to see if you agree with me. I don't preach to give you some information so you can go write it down, go tell somebody else. I'm giving you and declaring some things to you by the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So that you can grab a hold of it. It's miracle working power, and you can live it. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah. Yeah, this is good stuff. And so I just pray in Jesus' name that you begin to give yourself enough to the study of the Word that you recognize that it's spirit and life. It's not just, you know, black ink on white paper, words, you know, forming paragraphs, sentences and paragraphs and chapters. It's spirit and it's life. And if you should begin to so take a hold of the Word of God that you want to memorize it, you want it, you don't want it to depart from you, you want it, it's important to you. Do you know the thing about it is Father sees that. It isn't about you trying to please the pastor or impress anybody around you. It's about you responding to God. He sees that. He sees the cry and the desperation of your heart and says, maybe, you know, if you didn't have any ability to memorize anything, but there the Lord sees you laboring, you know, like 40 hours over trying to get one sentence memorized. Do you know how the impact that has on Father? I'm going to tell you right now, He'll heal you. He'll heal your memory. I guarantee you. He'll heal your memory. Hallelujah. I promise you, I'm not making a joke. I'm telling you, Father's looking for those who seek Him, who earnestly desire Him. And I'll just tell you, you don't get to step into the things of the kingdom until you hunger for them and thirst for them. And hunger is only defined by what you cannot live without. You eat because you can't live unless you eat. Thirst is only defined by what you cannot live without. You drink because you're going to die. You have to. And so, dear people, I just understand the reality of it is that many people have not given themselves enough to the things of what God has done for us through this so great a salvation to really begin to develop a great desire. That desire is something that's supposed to be there when we're born of the Spirit. And it's there. It just gets bombarded and it gets overwhelmed and shrouded by the things that are around you and other things placing demands upon you that seem to be more urgent. And you're going to have to get yourself some wisdom so you can prioritize right. You know, I want you to just open your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4, and I think it is verse 4. Hallelujah. My son so hooks up with heaven that even when he's not up there playing, I think he's up there playing. I just turned around and tell him to stop, basically. Hallelujah. He doesn't need to pray anymore. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, let me tell you something. Let me hear you this. Let me tell you this. You know, the enemy will come at us with sickness, with disease, with oppression, with torment, with harassment, with temptation. But listen to this. The more that you will stand up against it and not change your mind and not be moved, here's what happens. The more Satan has restrictions and limits put upon him, and the stronger you get. I'm telling you right now, the more you say no to any kind of temptation, I mean, let's just say sickness or disease started coming at you. And if instead of getting overwhelmed by it and say, what's wrong with me? What happened? What have I done? Will you just begin to worship the Son? Oh, I'm going to tell you right now, Satan and those things, it's like as a wrestling match. He's absolutely subdued and is not even allowed to come at you like that anymore. And then what happens is that you get stronger as a result. And I give you a perfect model of it. I mean, there's many models of it, but the perfect model of it is Jesus being tempted in the wilderness. You know that right after the temptation, after he dealt with all that Satan could throw at him, and I'm telling you, that was intense, the angels of the Lord came minister to him, huh? Hallelujah. Came strengthened him. Same thing happened in the Garden of Gethsemane. I mean, it was so intense, one blow after another, blow after another blow. There's a lot of people, they've never even stepped into enough usefulness in the kingdom to even have to take a blow. All they've done is have to deal with is just the peripheral little, you know, magic of Satan, if you would, where he just kind of, you know, throws a little water on your face, so to speak. You know what I'm saying? They've never had to take a blow, as it were. But, I mean, Jesus was taking blows right, left, and center in the garden, and he stood up against it, even with great turmoil and intensity, hallelujah, that he sweat great drops of blood. He sweat blood. I mean, you know, that's pretty intense stress. And then the angels of the Lord came, ministered to him, came and strengthened him. I pray you'll get in the fight. I pray you'll get something bigger than yourself going on. Hallelujah. I pray you get into the big move of that which God has purposed for us to do as citizens of the kingdom, as the heirs of God and co-inheritors with Christ Jesus, who've been given authority and given power and authority over every demon spirit to cast them out and to heal all sicknesses and diseases. You can find that in Luke chapter 9 and verse 1, Matthew chapter 10 and verse 1. Those are easy to memorize, aren't they? Kind of easy, hey? Both as, you know, 9-1, 10-1, 11, 12, 13 kind of thing. Are you with me? Hello? I mean, I want you to get this. I want you to get it in your spirit. I'm going to tell you right now, when you go home, if you just do this, you know, many years ago, I said, Lord, what can I do to help God's people to get a hold of these things? And so what I would do is every time I would speak, I would go home, and the next day I would write it out as a daily bread, and I would post it on everybody's email. And I'd post it even on the Facebook so that people could go over it again. Because if you don't, then it's not precious to you. I mean, once again, I know it may be precious to you, but the other things that are around you, places demands upon you, and you just can't seem to get out of it. You can't seem to get your priorities right of seeking first the kingdom of God because of all this other stuff. But I'm going to tell you right now, you take that thing to the mat, you wrestle it, you start biting it in its nose, okay? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But you know, whatever, clawing it in its eyes, whatever. I just say, look, I'm putting this thing to the ground and they're going to master me no more. And things would change. Yeah. You know, First John? You have 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, and it might be verse 3, but I'm going to go ahead and give it to you anyway, you'll understand. It says, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. You've overcome them, little children, huh? What does it say? You have overcome them, huh? What does it say? It says, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them. Or you could say, you have overcome them, little children, because you are of God. Amen. Either way, okay? In the Greek language, it's a little bit more like the latter. But your Bibles that you're reading, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them. What? All of these other forces, all these other influences, all these other wrong models, all these other voices. But no, that is, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm just going to be very honest with you, transparent with you. I don't want you to get upset. I want you to get encouraged. But there are very few people who live this life. Okay, there's very few people who live this life. But when you step into this life, you're going to have an abundant life. You're going to find joyful life. You're going to find power life. You're going to find an increase in anointing in such a way you start praying for people. They get healed. You say to talk to the devils and they leave. Hallelujah. No, I'm telling you, the thief comes to steal your power and authority because you listen to his lies. And this is really about listening to lies. This is not just about the instrument that the Satan would use, like false prophets. Believe not every spirit that has gone out into the world, but try them because many false prophets are at work. It's the spirit behind the false prophets. It's the spirit that talks to your thinking realm. Huh? It's the spirits that influence you. You know, a lot of people, they want to make this whole engagement, this whole thing that we're going through about, you know, a good guy and a bad guy on the inside of you fighting it out. God's on one side, devil's on the inside, and they're all fighting it out on the inside. You got this war going on inside. It is not some war going on the inside. I prove that to you. God, the Holy Ghost, has come to live on the inside of us. Amen. Greater is he that is on the inside versus he that is on the outside. See that? Can I put that down to you? This is really an interface between what's going on inside, because the power of God is in us. The power of God is in you. Hello. I mean, it's a wellspring springing and a river flowing. Wake up. I mean, get out your slumber and sleep. Give me a break. I mean, how many times got to hear the same thing before you understand it? You know what I'm saying to you? Before you believe it and stand in it. Are you with me? And so we got to grab this thing, and we got to recognize that the old man was crucified, put to death. Amen. Romans chapter 6, and I believe that's also verse 4. And that we've been circumcised with the circumcision of Christ and the removal of the body of the sins of the flesh. And that would be Colossians chapter 2 and verse 13. And it doesn't stop there. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Hallelujah. Everything old has passed away, and everything new has come. So I want you to understand, this isn't the struggle of something going on inside of you. It's a struggle between the greater one that is on the inside of you and that which is coming at you from the outside. And there's just very few people who's ever lived out 1 John 4:4. And it's my desire to see some people in this place begin to understand the battle that rages and how to be able to effectively deal with these things and understand if it's not the behavior of the Savior, kill it. If it's not the behavior of the Savior, stop it. Shut it down. Because all that is in the world, all the world lies in wickedness. Do you lie in wickedness? You need to see whether or not Christ is in you or whether or not you reprobate lying in wickedness. Huh? That's what the scripture says. Listen, Christ is in us. The Holy Ghost lives in here. And the Holy Spirit wants to teach us and show us how to move with God because we're willing to be taught the word. You make it up as they go. People just make it up as they go. They try to believe whatever it is they think that it's going to, you know, the popular doctrines or whatever is going to fit within the framework of what they're experiencing or what they're thinking or what kind of, you know, fits with what they're going through. Man, that ain't going to do anything for you. God has spoken His word. It's a miraculous power. His word is a miraculous power. If you agree with His word, you get the miracle. I mean, Father, just going to leave it that way. I mean, it's not like that we've got to speak it to create it. He's already spoken. It's already created. All we got to do is agree with it, and then we recipients of it. Hello. I want you to consider tonight. I want you to listen to me. I want you to understand that you have a power at work on the inside of you that will produce within you the love of Christ which passes knowledge and fill you with all the fullness of God. This is true. If you look in Ephesians chapter 3, I just worked my way backwards from verse 20 up to verse 19 to verse 18. Because if I go, I've gone 18, 19, 20 too long. And that ain't done a lot. So I'm going to go reverse it and come at it another way. And then I'm going to come at it sideways. Then I'm going to get on top of you and do whatever it takes. You know, to say, look, wait, hold up. What is it that you're contemplating when you're contemplating? When God lays His hand on you and says, receive, and you're going... Really, what it comes down to, people, is it really at the end of the analysis, are you going to rely upon yourself? Or are you going to rely upon the power of God? Because it isn't about an old man, new man, old nature, new nature. It's about whether you're going to trust in yourself or whether you're going to trust in God. I mean, Jesus said it over and over and over again. I don't do anything of myself. I can do nothing of myself. And then He tells us, and he says it in John 5, He says it in John 6, says it in John 8. Then He tells us in John 15, He says to us, He says, you can do nothing of yourself. But the reality of it is when we're in this interface where we, with the power of God, Christ in us, the greater one that is in the world, and the world is coming at us with all the stuff, whether it's fear, whether it's turmoil, whether it's worry, concerns, financial issues, or whether it's just the works of the flesh, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, or the pride of life, there is a power at work with us on the inside of us to be able to effectively say to that, no, but... If we're trusting in ourselves and looking to ourselves from some kind of bootstrap salvation and discipline, you know, sitting around talking about, I can't ever get it right, poor me. You know, that's nothing but a self realm. Oh, everybody's always picking on me. Why can't you just be understanding of me? No. No. We want you to change. God demands that you change. We want you to quit trusting in yourself. We want you to quit acting like that. Yes. We want you to take a hold of the power of God, because really, I want you to get this tonight. Don't disappoint me. Don't let me down. I want you to get this tonight. There is a war raging. It's not on the inside of you. There's a war raging. It's not on the inside of you. There's a war raging between that glory that has been placed on the inside of you, the excellency of His power and glory, okay, which is found there in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm on the fours tonight. And what is that? It's verse 6 or is it verse 7? This treasure that we have in these earthen vessels, verse 7. Hallelujah. I'm sure all you could do that. I didn't look at these verses before I came. I'm just preaching to you right out of what lives on the inside of me. The reason that this lives on the inside of me makes me an overcomer, because the word of God abides in me and I've overcome the wicked one. Now, if you don't get the word in you, come on now, you're listening to me. That's why I said, I'm telling you, we've given you all kinds of resources. You give me not YouTubes now. You can go look at them over and over. And now I said, I just took it to another level. I'm doing face streams every day, you know, just to help everybody at their noon devotions at 1 o'clock. You know, because if you don't understand how to seek the Lord evening and morning, and at noon will I pray. Well, if He was successful praying at evening and morning at noon, guess what would happen to you if you did it? If Daniel was successful, if Moses was successful, if David was successful and had what he got out of God doing that, if you'll imitate that, you'll get it too. You'll have the same success. People just yawn and go through life and just continue on with wrong priorities. Hello. Preaching up a storm here, I'm going to take my coat off. Say, it's not a struggle on the inside of me. I've been born again. I belong to God.
I belong to God.
And that should make you seriously happy. You know, it makes you serious happy. Satan comes along with his lies and his temptation, you start thinking, oh no, there's some terrible thing on the inside of me. I got some terrible root of iniquity, all this desire from hell's living on the inside. No, it's not. It's Satan coming at you. You're going to have to understand that there is something called a shield of faith. Hallelujah. And the shield of faith is just knowing what God has done for you. Believing that, wait a minute, I got a treasure in here. I got the power of God at work on the inside of me. That is, if I will just rely upon Him, I trust in Him. Understand this. The whole issue has always been about trusting God. You know, He's the God of trust. He's not the God of hope. He's the God of trust. I posted that for everybody today on Facebook and gave you some evidence so you can understand it. That this word El Peace is actually translated from a Hebrew word, batach, in the Hebrew language, which is always translated trust or competence or carefree. I'm carefree. Amen. I mean, why? Because I'm trusting God. That's where Adam blew it, and that's where Adam blew it, and Abraham succeeded. Adam got one little lying suggestion. He's just like the average Christian. Are you listening to me? I'm telling you, talking to you. He just like the average everyday Christian. Listen, one suggestion of Satan was taken out by it. Listen, one little lie of Satan, and then went ahead with it, exploded it inside. I mean, it took one little word and it allowed it to just grow into a mountain. One little thing, one little imagination. He made a whole history out of it, and story out of it, and future out of it. Are you listening to me? And then Abraham, God, he's in his 70s. Praise God. Most people's ministry in the Bible begin in their 80s. 70s or 80s. And so I'm trying to get all you prepared. I said, okay, well, you know what? If we didn't get them early, we'll get them later. Praise God. Amen. If we can just get people to start doing the right things. Hallelujah. Take care of their bodies. Start believing in divine health. God is He gives us divine health. People say, oh, how do you know that? Because by His stripes you were healed. You know what? It's like, I spend our life convincing people how blessed they are, and it's still just a struggle. No, I'm not blessed. No, that's not true. Well, I got sick. My great uncle, who was the holiest person who ever lived, he died of something. You know, it's just like trying to always overthrow the Word of God out of experience. You got to shut experience down. I mean, come on, people. I'm talking to you about the abundant life. I'm talking about the joy-filled life. I'm talking about the peace that passes understanding kind of a life. Hallelujah. Praise God. And Abraham, he's in his 70s, and the Lord says, I want you to leave. I want you to go out from where you're at, where you're living. And now, if he was like, just think about it. If you were Abraham, and now the Lord's not going to tell you where you're going to go, how much stuff to take. He said, I want you to leave, and I want you to head that way. Take off, and I'll show you where to go. He got the same issues you got. Got a job, got a house, got a family, got stuff. Most people can't do anything because of their stuff. Why am I doing my stuff? Who cares about your stuff? Your stuff's going to burn up anyways. I mean, come on. It perishes with the union. I got my stuff. He's got the same issues that you got. But what he's going to do is he's going to trust God. And as a result, he's going to become the heir of the worlds to come. I'm going to tell you right now, I was telling a guy about his soul. He was coming from, he was an accountant. It's kind of a high level person in accounting at a clinical group that takes care of places all around the U.S. And he just happened to be flying out of San Diego. And so I spent 3.5 hours, he stuck with me 3.5 hours. I said, hello, how are you? He said, I'm doing fine. And it basically, you asked the wrong question, what do you do? You're getting ready to find out. I preach. Hallelujah. We're going to talk to you about your soul. And, you know, as we went through the thing, you know, it come to a place, you know, he's like, you know, he had some background. I just could see the power of God was all over him. After 2 hours, listen to me. I'm going to get some breakthrough. And he was hungry because 2 hours, I mean, it's a 3.5 hour flight. And he was hungry. He wasn't shutting me off. He was interested, you know. He was just soaking it up. And you can always tell, you know, because when people aren't soaking it up, it's just bouncing off like it's bouncing off a wall. You know, you're stumbling over every tooth in your mouth. You know, you can't get anything out. There's no inspiration there. That means they're not receiving it. Just they're not listening to the Holy Ghost, who gives you the inspiration when you rely on inspiration. But at any rate, he said, well, you know, he said, I try to do, here's what he said. We got to a point, he asked me, well, what is secular humanism? And so I explained it, because I tell him the difference between secular humanism, fear of the Lord. And he said, well, I don't even know what secular humanism is. I explained to him. And he said, well, you know, I just try to do good and treat everybody right and just hope it works out in the end. I said, you're not good enough. And he looks at me like that. I said, that's secular humanism right there. What you feeling right now? That's secular humanism. You're not good enough. I said, there's only one way you can possibly be good enough, and that is to be cleansed by the blood and the life of Christ Jesus. That's why God came, died for you, so you could be good enough. You can't be good enough without him. He said, well, I'm not really scared. I said, I'm not really afraid of dying and going to hell. I said, I am. He didn't say dying and going to hell. He said, I'm not really afraid of death. I said, I am. I'm very much afraid of it. I'm very aware of the consequences that's going to happen when I breathe out my breath, last breath. I'm not going to spend forever and ever in a place called the lake of fire. I'm not going to spend forever. I'm not taking any risk of spending forever and ever. And I had spent 2 hours bringing him to a point of the observable realities of God. The observable realities of God. That's what this word, that was the sermon the Lord gave me for him. I mean, I get sermons all the time. I get so many sermons. I get a sermon for everybody I meet. Hallelujah. I get a word of God for everybody I meet. Why? Because I'm wanting to live there. The greater one lives on the inside of me. The preacher, the evangel, the spirit of the Lord, Christ Jesus. He lives on the inside of me. I'm not into thinking. I'm into flowing. I'm not into the self realm. I shut the self realm down. I shut the self realm down by saying, no, I'm going to trust God when the press is on me and it looks like I'm going to die, or it looks like things are going to be devastated, or it looks like somebody's going to get hurt, or it looks like things are going to be bad, or whatever. I just don't trust in myself. I trust in God. And when I trust in the God of all trust, right? Romans 15, 13, I ministered to that today. For those of you who watched me on Face Stream today, I ministered on Romans chapter 15, verse 13. The God of all trust will fill you with all joy and peace in believing. I mean, my goodness, when you get yourself into a place where you begin to cast all your concerns upon him because you know he cares for you, then the God of peace can rule your heart and mind with this wonderful realm of glory. What happens is we are dealing with whether or not, continually dealing with whether or not we're going to trust to our inner self, look to ourselves to do whatever it is we need to do, to bring forth the supply, to bring forth the correct response, to put things together, or whether we can trust in God. I mean, you know what I do when I'm in a perplexed situation? I just say, thank you, Father. We just watch what Father would do. Somebody said, make a decision. No, I don't have to. I was going to watch what God was going to do. Hallelujah. And usually it doesn't take long for God to give me a word of faith. Huh? It's just like you know where I first learned it from? When David basically got hit, the people that were following him in such a mess that they lost their children and their wives, and they're ready to stone him. What'd he do? He sat down. He sat down and worshiped the Lord. And then the Lord gave him something, told him what to do. People just go to thinking. They go looking to their self. They go looking to their own ability. See, if you're like me and you don't have a lot of human ability, it's easy to trust in God. When you can find out, wait a minute, I got something better going for me than me? You're kidding me. You know, I got some help now? Yeah, I got God kind of help, God intelligence. But I have to say, I'm not going to look to my own intelligence. I'm not going to look to my own strength. I'm not going to look to my own ability. Some people have so gotten so high on their human ability, there ain't no way God's got a chance of getting through. He's got to take you through a humbling process that is just, I mean, top shelf, over the top humbling process. The grandiose package of humbling process. And that's where people basically start walking with God when they're about 80. You with me? Yeah. Luke's got real quiet in here. But you don't have to do that, dear people. All you got to do is begin to define for yourself what's God's help and what's your help. And it fundamentally starts with something very simple. Am I going to trust God here, or am I going to start worrying? Am I trust God here, or am I going to become overwhelmed with a situation? Huh? Am I going to trust God here, or am I going to get stressed out? And then when you get stressed out, you are hard to live with. You just grumpy, huh? Snappy, short, edgy. You know what I'm saying? Come on, people. You edgy? You trusting in yourself. You worried about something, you can't give it to God. Huh? What's a beautiful thing is that you can learn how to talk to God. If you could just learn how to talk to Father, hallelujah, and walk with Him, you'll have yourself a relationship. I mean, you got to, before you can have a relationship with anybody, you got to talk to them. You got to learn how to talk to them. I've learned how to talk to Father. Well, somebody said, where'd you learn how? In prayer. Oh, man, that sounds like it's kind of overwhelming and boring. I mean, is that what you guys do every night, just go to prayer? Oh, yeah, that's what we do. Man, that sounds really boring. No. Not when things start shifting around. Huh? Not when the atmosphere changes and you got clothing, tongues of fire, and a rushing mighty wind. It's pretty exciting. In fact, I have a better time and more excitement. It's a bigger thrill in prayer than anything that you can do. You got to find that realm. See, if you learn how to talk to Him, you can learn how to talk for Him. Hallelujah. You don't learn how to talk to Him? People just, they just run out of things to say. You need to glory. Listen to me. Come to prayer and listen to me. You hear what I say. You can find a verse for everything I say when I talk to Father. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Makes me good, makes me excellent at quoting His word. Gives me the insight and the wisdom to perfectly apply His word so that I can find myself being in crisis situation, being flooded with confidence, being flooded with certainty, because His word overwhelms me and I hear His word speaking to me, which gives me faith and confidence and security. Yes. All of those words are part of the word that we translate hope, and that is pathetic. That is pathetic. You know, He's going to fill us with all hope. No, I'm not going to sit around here hanging on, hoping for a day. No, He fills us with all confidence and expectation and carefreeness and trust by the power of the Holy Ghost. That's a beautiful verse of Scripture when you get the words right. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. I don't want just hope. I don't want just hope. I was already in hope. Come on. You can have hope being just in. You can bring hope to people without the gospel. Build them a house. Give them some food. I tell them things are going to get better. I want that which only God can supply. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Can I get you into a place that you quit blaming something else for your stupidity? Yes. Hallelujah. Can I get you into a place that you quit blaming somebody else for the things that you're not willing to do? Because it's a doing, dear people. When you begin to be overwhelmed with something that begins to touch your emotions and your feelings, which now we can apply that to something that's like it's on the inside right now, right? We know who's on the inside, right? Yes. But now all of a sudden you start feeling sorrowful or sad. That feels like it's on the inside. Right. Don't feel like it's on the inside, outside anymore, does right. it? Huh? Sure. Well, what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to recognize that that thing is being placed upon you by something that's going on that you're accepting within the realms of self-reliance. Yes. And you just shut the thing down and you go, no, Holy Spirit, I want your joy to flow through me right now. I know you in here. You don't have to pray, oh God, rend the heavens and come down. Yeah. Somebody put that song up the other night where I was at a place in a meeting. I refuse to sing it. You know what I do when I refuse to sing a song? I stand there and go, no, I don't. I don't do that. I sing in Holy Ghost, so it looks like I'm singing, because I'm not going to create a scene. I'm not going to create strife. I'm not going to participate with something that is out of the realms of wickedness because I don't have anything to do with it. I don't have anything to do with that. I don't have anything to do with that outside of church. I don't have anything to do with it inside of church. When I see people doing it inside of church, I know there's a demonic stronghold in their life, and it rules them all the time. Huh? People said, oh, I was fine till I came to church. No, when you got church, you manifested. When you got church, you discovered what was there all the time. We saw it too. Are you listening to me? Are you listening to me? Yeah, because the reality of it is you can come to a place to where that you cross the line, where you just begin to agree with Satan, you begin to agree with his lies, you begin to accept his torment, and it becomes oppression on you. And now it rules you. That thing needs to be broken off of you. But other than that, if we just take it from the perspective of the being born again, and now you're walking in the Word, and you're trusting God, and you're relying upon the Holy Ghost, my goodness, you in the hallelujah. He that the Son sets free is free zone, okay? You in the, hallelujah. You in the glorious liberty of the sons of God zone. And then those people, the reality of it is you can begin to learn this day how no longer to yield your members as instruments or weapons of unrighteousness, but unto sin, unto transgression, but yield your members as weapons unto God, as weapons of righteousness, and bring forth the fruits of holiness. Huh? But if you don't get it right, if you just don't understand it, if you continue to trust in yourself instead of trusting God, I just want you to understand, I want to give you indicators. You're starting to feel overwhelmed, that's trusting in yourself. You're starting to get all upset and stressed out and worried, trusting yourself. You're opening up a door now to more problems. Hello. You know, if I could help you understand how to deal with the wickedness that is in this world. Because there's some people in here you've not yet fully dealt with the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And that's going to keep you from ever really moving with God. I mean, that's where Satan really comes to steal from you. He'll steal from you any similitude of God, ultimately. He'll steal from you the things of the anointing. You got to just understand, wait a minute, I'm in a battlefield and I'm not going to allow myself to embrace some cheap thrill as at the expense of walking in divine power and glory. Yeah. Come on. You're just going to have to grow up and get yourself some sense, some thinking sense. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Huh? Some basic practical thinking sense. And I can say this for every dimension of things that people deal with, from, you know, having arguments with people in your house, to having bad attitudes, to having offense. Somebody said to me not too long ago, said, how is it that you can, deal with somebody saying something bad about you or bad to you and you're unaffected by it? Because I live in a realm of peace. I live in a realm of communion with the Holy Ghost. I live in the Serimanda de Kishtepeyara. Now, if I started compromising that, then I would be more vulnerable, you know, to get all up in the offense that other people are involved in. I just won't allow it. I'm going to keep a perfect heart. I'm going to keep a clean heart. Huh? If somebody does something wrong to me, I'm going to forgive them. I'm going to do what God says to do. I'm not going to walk around saying they did me wrong. Who cares? I mean, I deserve a whole lot worse. Anybody say that again? Somebody spoke bad at me? Oh, they could have said something far worse and it probably been right. Are you listening to me? Yeah. I could have been deserving of it. People walk around in the pride of life, and in the pride of life, they're all in self-defense. Huh? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, come on. If it wasn't for the grace of God, who knows? I'd probably be that. Right. And when it was a lie or something that wasn't true. But if it wasn't for the goodness of God and the grace of God, I could easily be that. So, I mean, I'm just praising God that he's made me what I am. Yes. So, therefore, there's no offense. Are you listening to me? Yes. You got to decide. Are you going to rely upon the Holy Ghost who's on the inside of you, who's right now providing the power for you and I to walk out the fullness of him that fills all things, to live in the love? I mean, you know, it's just easy to forgive people and to show mercy when you're being filled up with love. Amen. And the beautiful thing of it is the fill up with love is being supplied on the inside. But the reality of it is it comes down to this. Who are you going to trust? And you're going to be in some tough situations. You thought little girl had appendicitis today, right? And you had to take her to the hospital because she'd been sick. And then get to the hospital, she got healed. Huh? That's pretty cool. Hey, she got totally healed at the hospital before the doctor saw her. Is that correct? Is that what happened? Pretty much. She went from, you know. But I'm going to tell you, I know what fear sits in. It could be appendicitis. Her heart could be failing. Her brain could be shutting down. Are you with me? Fear. Fear overwhelms you. What happens when love fills you and confidence fills you? And the Lord is long-suffering, and he's merciful, and he trains us. And the more that you stand up to the battle and you do not flinch and you don't go with the suggestions of the enemy, what happens is a line is drawn in the sand. Satan is not allowed to do that. He's not allowed to advance any further, and you grow stronger. I mean, it's just like if you had addictions or things in your life where you had problems or whatever, that things you just couldn't get over. But you just stood up against it and you said no. By the Spirit of the Lord, you said no. I belong to heaven. I'm not going to do this. Or maybe it was before you gave your life to the Lord and you were having a struggle whether or not you wanted to give that up, in response to accepting this wonderful new life in Christ Jesus. But when you did, when you just obeyed God and you stepped out in obedience to God and you stood up against it, it ultimately became something that had no power over your life anymore. Well, when is it that, I'm going to just tell you, when is it that you're going to stand up and start doing what's right in God? If you'll do it on every level, it works that way on every level to where that you can begin to live out this life of walking in everything that belongs to the realms of what God is supplying and become one that is untouchable by Satan. You decide. God, listen, I want to say this again. God is long-suffering. He's merciful, but he demands holiness. People say he's God that doesn't demand holiness. They're talking about the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world. He demands obedience. He demands righteousness. And he empowers us to do it. But we're going to have to get serious about whether about what's right and what's wrong. We've got to recognize that the fear of the Lord has been brought to us, hallelujah, so that we can understand that wrong has got a terrible consequence to it, that the wages of sin is death. God has given us wisdom to understand that if we sow to the flesh, we will of the flesh reap corruption. And then that's painful, huh? Listen, it hurts to trust in yourself. It's very painful to trust in yourself. All this stuff you're going through, that's you. Well, I wish that God would come. No, God's already come. I wish he would supply. He's already supplied. Oh, what does it take for me to get in the gifts of the Spirit? Get out of yourself. Oh, what does it take for me to go into more of the things of the anointing? Get out of yourself. Because you can't live your life in the life of Christ. Jesus said, I cannot do anything of myself. I only can do what Father gives me to do, he shows me to do, what he empowers me to do. Well, Father's shown you all kinds of things. He's shown you what to do. You've just got to be willing to start trusting him. There's not a person in here that's had to trust God at the level that Abraham did. There's nobody in here that the Lord said, okay, listen, I'm going to deliver the word to you, Josh, tomorrow morning. You're going to go buy a ticket, one-way ticket to somewhere. And when you get up there, you'll know exactly where somewhere is. And then when you get there, then you're not coming back. And when you get there, the Lord will tell you the next thing to do. Well, that's one thing. Josh's single, and he don't have much stuff.
That's true.
Huh? But then I say, Joshua. I'm going to say David, because he's got more kids and more stuff. David, I was giving him the same scenario. Now he's a little bit more perplexed. He's going to start asking me a bunch of questions. Huh? Can you hear me?
Yes.
And it didn't end there with Abraham. Abraham went from one place of trusting God to the next place of trusting God to the next place of trusting God to ultimately the Lord says to him, now go sacrifice your son for me. I want you to go give him to me on the altar. And he went in a struggle. He trusted God. He knew who God was. He had to walk with him. He knew how to talk with him. He knew how to walk with him. He knew what Father was going to do. At that moment, Isaac was dead. He didn't have to wrestle with it. He didn't have to ask him, are you going to get a guarantee me that you're going to raise him from the dead? And then go through all the stuff that you might go through with your thinking realm. You're going to have to shut that down.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Do you have a greater one living on the inside of you?
Yes.
Do you also have a loser living on the inside of you?
No.
Thank you. It's helping. You have a greater one living on the inside of you, except for when the loser's there. There is no loser. If you're in the Word of God, if you've been born of the Spirit, then your life has to fit, and you have to begin to agree with the description of your life that is given to you in the Word.
Amen.
Yes. Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Some of you need to adjust your halo. The other night, I'm in North Dakota. I stood up and I started to faint. Started to pass out. My head started hurting so bad. And I almost like I couldn't see. And I became extremely faint. And my extremities, my fingers started tingling. What do you reckon I did? Call 911. Something bad's happening here. Huh? And then if you got a little bit of clinical information, then you get go. Then you go real wild. A little bit of information does great damage to you. Huh? Right? The Fred Sanford thing. I'm always having a heart attack kind of thing. Over the sinus kind of thing. That's, you know what I did? You know what I did? Worship. That's what I did. That's what I did. I just worshiped. Because the reality of it is, I've already gone through this over and again. Now, what happens is, a little bit of cold comes on you, right? You feel it in your throat. Or a little pain, or a little symptom of something that you begin to think it's this or it's that. And then you go with it. You just become overwhelmed by it. Well, reality of it is this, the Lord tells us that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in us. He'll make you quicken and immortal body. But you've got to believe that. Romans 8, verse 11, you've got to be able to believe that. A lot of folks don't believe. They're going to run to the doctor. I've got to go to the doctor before I die. What is that called? That is called you are looking to yourself to save you. If Father's ready for you to come home, you should be very happy. See, it's time. We're leaving now. We're leaving now. Praise God. I mean, if you know it. Otherwise, you're just going to have to begin to deal with opposing powers of darkness that are coming out against you. I knew what God was getting ready to do in that place. I knew I was getting ready to deal a fatal blow to the hindering spirits in that house. And the hinder and powers of darkness that had oppressed people in all kinds of sorts of way in that place. And Father did it. And sometimes, you know, the enemy will come at us. He'll come at us spiritually through thoughts, feelings. He'll come at us physically with things that hitting, you know, our body. And we just got to, if we understand how to just look to the Lord, how to just trust Him, how to with total abandonment to say, Lord, I know You have me. I know that you exist and that You hear. Yeah. Hallelujah. I mean, when I stood up and I started preaching, it was a flood of heaven. I mean, it was a flood of heaven. The volume of my voice was about 3 to 4 times louder than what it is right now. Huh? There was none of those things that were coming against me. I didn't allow any of those things to affect me. I don't allow the feelings to change the way that I feel. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I don't allow the thoughts to change the way that I think. Can you hear me? Yes. I don't allow situations to describe to me what I have. I don't allow circumstances to tell me how I'm going to be or how I will live. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm living by the Word of God. And you know what? And sometimes you just have to say, look, I remember, I wanted to say this. I try to help you understand this in every way possible, because there's simply so many people that just go with whatever's happening around them. Whatever's going around you, that is what your mood is. What is that little lizard that changes colors with every, huh? Huh?
A chameleon?
Please, why be so flexible and adjustable and adaptable to your environment? Why can't you just live in the Holy Ghost? Why can't you just live in joy and peace and love all the time? Why can't you just choose goodness and life and health and strength and prosperity and blessing and just be that? Why? Why must you change with every little boo, run for the hills, with every little scare thing, you duck underneath the bed. With every little suggestion, you got it, it's yours. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
There's people that say, oh no, I got around somebody's got a cold. I get a cold. Anytime I get around somebody's got a cold, I get a cold. Or they say, oh, it's November, I'm going to get a cold. We always get colds in November. You've already agreed with it. It's already yours. You have a different word that you're living by. There is no battle going on between you, the greater one that is on the inside of you, huh? And he that is in the world. If the greater one's on the inside of you, that means the lesser one's in the world. We actually are guaranteed to be able to overcome in every situation, to be successful in every situation. God defeats Satan every time. Just like when you turn the lights on, the darkness leaves the room. Amen. If we turn the lights off right now, it'd get kind of dark in here. Yeah. In fact, it would get really dark in here. We would really need, if I turn all the lights off, we wouldn't be able to see each other in here. No. Are you with me? Yeah. This is just how easy this is. You choose, am I going to trust God? Are you willing to say, oh, Holy Spirit, arise within me? But if you believe that you're carrying around, you got some kind of contaminant on the inside of you. You got some kind of iniquity that's bunking in there. You just can't get it out. It just bounces around from time to time inside of you and creates all this mess. You're without hope. If you believe that it's going to be something that you out of your own self are going to be able to do in conflict against Satan, you're once again, that's painful. You lose. You lose. Somebody told me, he said, you know, I've been really dealing with something and I don't know whether I'm trusting in myself or I'm trusting in God with this. I said, I can answer you. I can tell you right now. No problem. Whether it's you or God. You ready? He said, wow, yeah. I said, are you being successful? Are you overcoming? No, that's you. No, I'm defeated every time. Yeah, that's you. Well, how do I get out of me? Start trusting God. What? Yeah, start trusting God. Well, how do I do that? It's real simple. Begin to praise Him. Begin to thank Him for divine ability. Sometimes people, it's just as simple as saying, no, there are so many things coming at the people from every direction, especially the youth, probably like never before in the history of men, walking around with these iPhones where you can actually access every good and every wicked thing on the planet. And I believe it's like giving a child the right to drive a race car. They're not old enough. They're not mature enough. It's like giving a child the right to go into a bar and drink alcohol. They're not old enough. They're going to make the wrong choices. We entrusting things to children who don't even know how to think yet. I know that a 15-year-old thinking how to think. A 14-year-old. But I'll just tell you right now. You stupid with a capital S. You stupid. You don't know how to process. You don't know how to think about consequences. You think about the living here and the now. You make choices out of the here and now. You're stupid. Sorry. I'm 57 years old. I understand. I've already been stupid. I was stupid too. And once you get to look back on stupid, you can really define stupid. Boy, was I stupid. And that's really about the way that the whole judicial system is set up. You recognize, wait a minute, how old was this person when they did this act? And so people, we got to understand that, and I mean, this is one of the things that really consumes my prayer time is praying, especially for the men and for the young men and even for the children that are walking around with iPhones and all of the stuff that you can stumble across every day. I mean, almost every day I have somebody send me a Facebook message that they want to become my friend, and I look and I go, no, you're not going to become my friend. Cancel. Huh? Because they're wanting to become my friend for all the wrong reasons. But where does that resolve come from? That resolve and that ability to obey God comes from time and time and time again of just obeying God, saying, I've chosen not to live my own life. I've chosen not to have my own will. I've chosen to become the slave and the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. I've said, Father, I want to do your will. Father, I don't want to do my own will, but your will. So I said, I don't have a choice anymore. Okay? I choose only to do what's right. I recognize anything that's not the behavior of the Savior, and I kill it. Amen. Delete request. Huh? Come on. Well, I wish you had a delete request for everything that's coming through your head right now. And tomorrow. Listen, we watch people live the roller coaster life. Oh, well, I wonder what they're going to be this service. Down here or up here or somewhere in between. Huh? Are you listening to me? the emotional roller coaster of your endocrine system. Oh, Lord Jesus. Huh? The emotional roller coaster of the, of your disposition, of the way that you're thinking. What happens when you all of a sudden say, wait a minute, I live in love, joy, and peace, and I don't allow anything else? Then you get to understand what the shield of faith is for. Wow, I really need that shield of faith. Where's that thing at? I understand what that's for, but until you begin to put upon yourself, wait a minute, I have a requirement to shine as the light of the world. I have a requirement to walk in the Spirit and to live in the Spirit and move in the Spirit. It's not optional. I don't get to just have my little happy time when I go to church and start worshiping God and then live totally depressed for the rest of the time. And even your happy time when you're supposedly worshiping God doesn't look too good either. It certainly isn't what it's supposed to be, because it can be, because you've not given yourself to the development of it in your everyday life. You've never learned how to talk with God. Because if something has created within your life a conflict that has compromised you. If anybody believed that they have an, oh man, I hope, I've seriously killed him. If I've not killed him, I've rendered him so damaged that he probably would not live. Because if you've been born again, that only lives within your mind, but that gives Satan all kinds of wiggle room, and now you're never going to understand what it means to be an overcomer. I'm always dealing with people that are still trying. I still hear them saying, I hear them pray the prayer of unbelief. Oh, Lord, create within me a clean heart. I want to slap them. I'm just like, please. I just hold myself back. And then I kindly and I gently say, you know, when you call upon the name of the Lord, and he comes and he saves you. He gives you a clean heart. Are you saved? Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I never thought of it that way. And then, you know, meet them a week later, and they're still praying. Oh, Lord, give me a clean heart. You know, and that's because a stronghold of lies have taken up place in their life. Father says that if we will purify ourselves or cleanse ourselves from all of their influence. 2 Timothy chapter 2. He says, if we'll cleanse ourselves from all of their influence, he said, then we will be fit for the master's use. Cleanse ourselves with all the influences of those false doctrines, of the hypocrisy, of going with living out. Because you're going to live out what you're thinking. You're going to live out your attitude. In fact, your attitude defines you. Oh, she's happy sometimes. Or if you're Anne, she's happy all the time. She's an amazing person. She is. That's what everybody says about her. She's happy all the time. Anybody know that Anne's sad? Raise your hand. Has anybody ever seen Anne sad? I have. But only for a few seconds, because she gets right out of it. Are you listening to me over here? Kato basikete le mapatarate. Oh, well, she's special. It's her genetics. It's just the way she was born. Yeah, you all about a self realm. Huh? You need to get over and stop living out a self realm and of your genetics. And then my mother was this way. My grandmother was this way. And it skipped one generation, but it came back on us. I hear these things. You talk about these things. You think these things. When are you going to get born again and believe it? You've been born again, but when are you going to believe it? You've been made a new creation, but when are you going to believe it? God's come take up residence inside of you, but when are you going to believe it? When are you going to understand that God who's at residence inside of you is at war against all those things that are out there that you're allowing to influence you, and you're going to become a war against it as well? He's at war against it. He's at war against all that is in the world. The whole world lies in wickedness and all of its sorrow and all of its sadness. The redeemed of the Lord. He defined the redeemed of the Lord. The redeemed of the Lord come with singing. I'm singing. That's what the Lord says. Be filled with the Spirit and start singing. He says in Ephesians chapter 5, he says, be filled with the Lord. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Huh? And speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing and make melody in your heart, giving thanks unto God. Well, we just do that like when? Sunday mornings? you're not going to live the life. You're not moving in the life. You're not moving with the Holy Ghost. You're not going to grow. You're not going to develop. You're not going to ever understand the abundant life. You're not going to come to the fullness of life. It's always going to be fictional Christianity. Because you're listening to a wrong doctrine. God told you to be at war. He told you, he said, listen to me. And Father's not going to allow you to go through more than you're able. But when you start wanting to start, when you want to start moving with God, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to have greater responsibility, and Satan's going to come at you with greater force. And he says, therefore, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. It's just telling us, he's telling us to be strengthened by the Spirit in the inner man. He said it there in Ephesians chapter 3. And it's verse 16, be strengthened in your inner being with the Holy Ghost. Amen? Amen. Hey, let the Spirit of the Lord strengthen you in your inner being. And then by the time he gets to Ephesians 6:10, he says, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. I receive it the same way. Why? Because I'm in conflict. Satan is a rebel. He hates God and he hates you. And he's going to come and try to put everything on you that he possibly can. And he's going to do it forcibly. And you're going to have to understand who you are and get yourself some authority. Hallelujah. You have to understand what you're going to believe and what you're going to do and how you're going to feel. And if you reach out your hand and you touch the unclean thing, he's got you, man. Praise God for the mercy of the Lord. Praise God for the blood of Jesus Christ. But guess what? He's going to come back even with greater force because he's declaring that person, whoever that person is that's touching the unclean thing, that's mine. My stamp's on him. You watch it. I'll make him do my little dance. I'll make him not hit the confirm, the deny or delete button over and over again. Anytime I want to. Anytime I want to. He's mine. You know what? I would be afraid to think for one moment that Satan had a claim upon my life. That he could do whatever he could, that there would be anything going on in my life that he could make me do at his will. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you've got recurring sin, that's Satan making you do something at his will. You're not master over him. He's master over you. And God's mercy, God's long-suffering, and God's merciful, and he deals with us, and he pleads with us, and he continues to go after us to teach us. But you and I are going to have to get serious about the war. We're going to have to get serious about the consequence of sin. We're going to have to get serious about the power of God that has been given to us to walk right, to live right, to do right. And, you know, I try to keep swinging the dimensions of how these things affect different people. I'm telling you, I don't believe that the Lord has excluded anyone from being a witness of the resurrection. But I have almost had to, in my heart, to think that he has just to be able to deal with many people's unwillingness to move forward in God. Huh? The Lord didn't leave you sad, sorrowful, and miserable. Huh? The Lord didn't leave you depressed and overwhelmed and not growing and maturing in the gifts of the Spirit. No, I'm telling you right now, the Spirit of the Son crying, Abba, Father, would develop a greater passion and a love and a greater wisdom and an insight and a greater revelation for the things of heaven, people.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Hallelujah. 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 And then, you know, when you look at it, in 2 Timothy, is it 3:17? I think it is. And what does the Lord say there in 2 Timothy 3:17, that the man of God may be perfect, huh? Thoroughly equipped, completely equipped, got some skills, huh?
Yes.
Built up, established, thoroughly able ministers of the Holy Ghost, huh?
Yes.
Thoroughly equipped, what? Unto every what?
Good work.
What is a good work? Jesus went about doing good works. What kind of good works? He healed all that were oppressed of the devil. Hallelujah. Amen. And he said that you can do these works, these good works. Hallelujah.
Yes.
And greater good works than these. And that's the kind of good works he's talking about. Well, what is making us perfect and thoroughly equipping us? What is it? The Word of God. Verse 16 tells you. 3:16. Everybody, I know everybody in this place has memorized 2 Timothy 3:16. Not. But you should. Masaya poko rasina mateya kinga lapa ora sipraha mendefrite. my lungs are saying. 2 Timothy 3:16, for the word of God, it's inspired. I already did seven, it's verse 17, so we're on 3:16, right? Yeah. Everybody in this place should have memorized verse 16, right? Here you go, let me read it. Let me read it to you guys. Here's the question, are you going to live by the word or are you going to live by your opinion? Are you going to live by the word or by your opinion? The word said, let not the inhabitants. Does the Lord say, I'm sick? Just think about it. I heard Oral Roberts, I heard other men of God personally tell me and say to me, listen, when the Pentecostals came to the meeting, nobody got healed. But when the Baptists and the Presbyterian and the Methodists and the Episcopalians came, everybody got healed. Well, why was that? Because the Pentecostals have grounded themselves in doubt and unbelief. They're supposed to already have the authority and power to not even come to the meeting sick.
Right.
Are you listening to me? Hello. You said you've been trained wrong. You let experience take the word of God from you. I want you to rise up out of what you're in. Start doing your, get yourself in the midst of the battle. Start fighting a good fight of faith. I don't know that there's very few people even fighting a good fight of faith. Others saying they're fighting a good fight of faith while they're ministering to their sickness. That's not fighting a good fight of faith, ministering to your sickness. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Caring for it, taking care of it, babying it, recognizing, checking to make sure it's still there. Hallelujah. Oh, no, Pastor, that's why God gave us doctors. That's self-realm. Self-realm. I can show, we can walk through the scripture, I can show you so many places where man relied upon what he could do. He relied upon himself. That's why the scripture says, cursed is the man who relies upon himself. Cursed is the man who trusts in men. It's the same way, just a rephrase of it. Cursed is the man who relies upon himself. How many would you like to be cursed? How many of you want to be cursed? Just raise your hand right now. You want to be cursed. Ain't nobody wants to be cursed. Well, quit relying upon yourself. Start trusting in God. Hallelujah. And so somebody said, well, how am I going to trust in God? You can grab a hold of 2 Timothy 3:16. And you're going to recognize that all scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's God-breathed. All scripture, the word of God, is powerful and it's living. Hallelujah. The word of God will work effectually in you that will believe. It will work with divine power. What will it do? It will work with divine power to produce within your life the results that it described. It will work with divine power in your life to produce the faith that moves mountains out of the way. But you're going to have to grow in that, and you're going to go through a lot of challenges, and you're going to have a lot of issues come at you. And you're going to, and some of them you probably are going to, some of them are probably going to take you out. It's probably going to, you're going to probably just bend and bow to them for a while. And then maybe after a while, then you're going to get sick and tired of getting pushed around. And you're going to stand up and say, no, I'm taking this thing to the mat now.
Amen.
I'm going to start pushing you back. You have no right. The Lord said, having done all, stand, stand. Come on, don't you back down. Don't move. You say, well, look, I believe in divine help. I'm not moving. I'm going to stand here. And there can, you know, it's just the situation and the circumstance and the problem and the issue has an opportunity or has a right, as it were, to press against you for a season, for a period of time. I'm here to testify to you that you win every time you put your trust in God. I'm here to tell you right now that as you trust God, faith arises in your heart and becomes powerful and becomes effective through your life. If I've got the fight and the battle for you now, do I got your sorrow and sadness on the outside of you or on the inside of you?
Outside.
How many of you really believe it's on the outside? Good. Don't let back in. Joy is sorrow and sadness repellent. Somebody say, well, I really want joy. Well, get saved. He comes and he gives us his joy. It's the joy of his salvation.
Hallelujah.
This is the joy of his salvation.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, well, I wake up in the morning and I feel bad. Well, then let the wellspring spring. And let the river flow, just flow. Somebody said, how do you walk out this? How do you live out this life in Christ Jesus? How do you have this walk of faith? I just say to the Holy Ghost, I know how to talk to him. Holy Spirit, I know how to talk to him because the Word of God trained me. Huh? The Word of God thoroughly equipped me unto every good work. Hallelujah. It told me exactly what God is doing so that I could do it with him. Are you listening to me? Everybody smile. You know, when your eyes are sad and you're smiling, it looks like you're about to bite something, like a dog. Not good. Get your eyes happy with your face. They got to match up. It really looks bad. If you're rehearsing for a horror movie, that would be fine. You could do that one and you'd probably get the part. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I just look whatever possibility I can find to get people to hook up with recognizing. I mean, everybody is smart enough to recognize the difference between being joyful and being sad. There's no one that is that clueless. But yet God's people are willing to accommodate sad and sorrow and heaviness. And so you're just going to have to learn how to hook up. You're going to learn how to put your hand on your belly or put your hand on your head, whatever it needs, and just begin to say, Holy Ghost, fill me with your joy. I'm going to yield myself to your joy. I've got to say no. I have to say no to something. You have to say no to sin. You have to say no to sorrow. You have to say no to the things that belong to the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye. You got to say no to bad attitude, wrong attitude. I can't believe they treated me that way. Well, believe it and get over it real quickly. They did. They treated you that way. Now forgive them. Jesus. Oh, you see, if you just had this, you got a glorious church. If you got people walking around constantly in love with each other, in love. Well, you can only be in love with each other because you're in love with God. People that don't feel loved, It's because they got a problem with the love relationship with the Lord. They got a problem with love, period. I don't feel loved. God, first of all, God never called you to be loved. You know, half of the scripture says, now you're going to really be loved by everybody. Somebody's got some wrong expectations here. He says, you're going to really be hated by everybody, actually. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And he said, you're going to love everybody. He said, you're going to love everybody. You know, one of the ways that I began to deal with the wrong influences that I was yielding to and was unaware of it, is I said to the Lord, I want to learn how to love somebody in the first 5 seconds. And what happened is through that, I discovered how much of the self realm and how much of the prince of the power of the air, the atmosphere, the things that go on in everybody else's behavior and everybody else's life was influencing me. Because as soon as you see people, you do the old elevator run on them for the crown of the head that says the feet. Okay? You go and you evaluate them. You get suspicious probably. You decide what you like about them or don't like about them. This is all going on in a matter of seconds. You're deciding whether you like them or don't like them. Huh? It's the sniff thing. It really is. It's dogs sniffing each other. It's living a lower life. It's living an animal life. God's called us up beyond a human life. And we don't even get it because the spirit of this world is saturated with hate and strife and division and envy. It is. It's everywhere. It's like imposed upon you. Do you hear me? It's imposed upon you. It's like walking into a force field of this stuff, and you're going to have to understand that it has no right to be a part of your behavior if it's not the behavior of the Savior. Amen. Say, I'm not having it. I'm not doing that. Hallelujah. But you have to understand, we submit ourselves to God. And then now, how the beautiful thing of it is, if you're going out, and you've not submitted yourself to God, you're not relying upon the Holy Ghost. It's an act of your will to rely upon the Holy Ghost. He doesn't just come in and take over, and now you don't even have a will anymore. You have to understand, you have to submit yourself to God. You have to say, it's almost like giving God permission to bless you. Saying, Holy Spirit, you wake up in the morning, you say, Holy Spirit, I want to walk with you. I want you to fill me. I want to be obedient to you. I want to be sensitive to you. I do not want in any way to grieve you. I thank you that you're with me and that you're in me. You're amazing. I can't even believe I got this kind of mentorship and companionship. It's amazing that you're even here, but you are, and I'm just rejoicing about it. Now you already submitted to God. It's a tough thing not to be submitted to God, being overwhelmed by the enemy. Now you're like, how do I submit to God? You know, you're getting beat up, pummeted by every situation around you. Oh God, I'm submitting to you right now. Help me. You're taken by the wind of circumstance. Well, here's what it is. You are either every day going to get up and say, I give myself, I commit myself. Listen to me. Don't go anywhere. Stand right there. You wake up every day and you say, you commit yourself, I am going to step into the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus. And if you don't, then there's only one choice that you're left with. To be tossed. Well, just go pray in the Holy Ghost. It'd get better. You know, if you so toko la mazavrivekidina la masabra bamaya, make your children feel a whole lot better than struggling with it. Can you hear me? Yes. I want you to be changed. I don't have to look at the old you ever again. I want to have to look at you and yourself ever again. I hate my own self and life in this world. You understand? How much more do I despise you? Are you listening to me? Compared to what God has given me, quit being a false witness. Compared to what God has given me, I hate my life that was in this world. Are you with me? I hate it. Compared to what He's given me, I've got the God life. I received the life of God. You received the life of God. Wake up. Wake up. Slap yourself. I got to wake up. Please stick your head out the window while you're driving. Get this coat in. Get this cold shower. Whatever. I don't know. Wake up. The life of God's on the inside of you. Christ Jesus lives on the inside of you. It's about time the church starts rising up. If you just begin to live this out every day, it becomes a living reality expressed through you. Huh? I mean, I love you. I despise the self. You understand? When I said I despise you, I love you. I despise the self. The self realm. It's just stinking ugly, man. You can have all the makeup on. You can be the prettiest person on the face of the earth. And you in the self realm, you ugly. U-G-L-Y ain't got no alibi. And you could be plain Jane, don't look like anything, but you got the glory of the Lord on you. You're the most beautiful person walking on the face of the earth. Face of the earth. Amen. Face of the earth. I got it right. Hallelujah. It's true. It's true. He beautifies the meek with his salvation. I'm on Jessica. Hallelujah. That's my beauty aids. Hallelujah. How many times the Lord says over and again that He dwells in us, the Father dwells in us, His Holy Ghost dwells in us, that Jesus dwells in us, that His power dwells in us, that His glory dwells on the inside of us. Over and again, so many different ways. He came from the top, He came from the bottom, He came from both sides, trying to hit us every way, which way, telling us that He's resourced us and He's empowered us to face whatever we're going through and not be overwhelmed by it and not be overcome by it. But yet we still are overwhelmed by it and overcome by it. Why? This is why I want you to get it. I'm going to say it. If I got to say it 100 times tonight, I'm going to say it till it penetrates. I'm just not going to give you a bunch of different things. I'm going to give you a couple of different things. Keep saying them over and over again. It's because you rely on yourself. It's the crossroads where you're either going to do it, where you're going to rely on yourself, or you're going to rely on God. You don't even know how to rely on God unless you hear His word, know His word. I want to hear you pray His word. I want to hear you quote His word. Don't you tell me that somehow you remember it when you see it. Oh, yeah, I know that verse of Scripture. Oh, yeah, well, you don't know that verse of Scripture because you couldn't say it before you saw it. You couldn't bring it to mind. Hello. Are you listening to me? Get yourself in the Word of God. Get yourself thoroughly equipped unto every good work. So understand, this: the Word of God is the shield of faith. It's what His Word has said that gives to us the ability to stand up against anything that's coming at us and say, no, you can't have me. No, you can't touch me. You have no right to do that. Oh, mighty God. I don't want anyone walking out of here tonight with sickness in your body, disease in your body, torment in your mind. It's time to, you know, the cure for depression and melancholy. Listen, depression and melancholy, sorrow and sadness, it is an oppressive evil spirit. It is an oppressive evil spirit. It is an oppressive evil spirit. Do you hear me?
Yes.
The power of God that is on the inside of you is power enough to take care of.
Amen.
Because Father wants to fill you with joy and peace. Hello.
Amen.
And if you're really hungry for the kingdom of God and you're seeking it, then you're going to have righteousness, joy, and peace.
Amen.
See, some of you just stumbled over that. I just go ahead and say it. Yeah, that's right. That's the first syllable, kind of. Do you know where those verses of Scripture are? I know you know. Do you know where they're at? To you sitting here today, you know where they're at. Is that your treasure? Are those your riches? Is that your place of safety and authority? Huh? I'm seeking first the kingdom of God, but fundamentally, then I'm going to have righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. It's not righteousness and joy and peace because you just got to, you know, tell yourself, you're supposed to be happy, you're supposed to be happy, you're supposed to be happy. You're supposed to do good, you're supposed to do good. I failed. Righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost means that you know how to submit yourself to the Holy Ghost. You know why we lay hands and pray? We lay hands on you and pray for you? You know why we lay hands on you and pray for you? So that you learn how to yield yourself to the Holy Ghost. You know why we want you to go to prayer and learn how to talk to Father? So you learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost. You know why we preach to you the way we do? Because we preach in describing those things that are necessary for you to do to learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost. You don't do them. You yield yourself to the spirit of this world. That's going to work counter. You yield yourself constantly looking to yourself. It's going to work counter. When you just recognize this is what the Holy Ghost is doing, He's doing joy and peace. Therefore, I'm going to do joy and peace. He's doing righteousness and purity. Therefore, I'm going to do righteousness and purity. And you're relying on Him and His strength and His ability to do it. People, it doesn't take long to get strong in the Lord. It didn't take long to get strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His mind. It didn't take long to be strengthened by His Spirit in your inner man. Hallelujah. That's why we lay hands on you. And those of you who don't come up to get your hands laid on you, you just sit back, and then you don't. And then I can see that you don't know how to really flow in the Holy Ghost. You know, I know that, here's the bottom line, I just know you don't get it. And so what do? Patiently, we just go ahead and tell you again. Until all of a sudden, you get so hungry for the things of God, you can't live without it. And when you begin to get hungry with the things of God, it won't be long. And you'll begin to have the expression of the things of the Holy Ghost in your life. And the things that Father has given us will profit you. They'll profit you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Can I convince you tonight that joy is available to you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week? And that you choose not to be happy? Tough choice. No, the circumstance made me do it. No, you don't understand. I got a bad phone call. No, you don't understand. So-and-so did this to me. No, you don't understand. I got a pain in my right toe. We've got all these reasons and these excuses. That's the self realm.
Yeah, that's
the explanation realm.
Yeah. When you recognize, wait a minute, God is on the inside of me. How many of you in here tonight, God's on the inside of you?
Yes.
Wow. Then you have no excuse. The only thing that's going on is you just don't understand that a war is taking place that is coming to you from the outside, and you're allowing it to have dominance over you. You're allowing it to have dominion over you. If you'll engage in the battle and start fighting a good fight, you'll understand what it means to live in divine health. You'll understand what it means to live in divine provision. You'll understand what it means to grow in grace and grow in the gifts of the Spirit and the expression of the Holy Ghost through your life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. I want you to start praying in the Spirit. Romo mancando le vesti chi tiri, mamando le debre di chiri di andare la masciara, morando le vecchiri alle le maserre di chirando le divivivi di chiarra ma masciaio, Gesù di tutto le genere na maserre di chiriando le vejarra di deia, morando le mamme mesciquisi, morando le mamme mesciquia la lala, mamma non è mesciquia la bebe, mandando le mamma non se parano. Now throw a few thank you Jesus in there. Corrama mamma da sa thank you Lord Jesus. Now, let me just say this to you. See, the atmosphere of your life will start changing, and the more you give yourself to these things, the atmosphere of your life will start changing. And it should grow and mature enough to where it just takes a thank you, Lord, and you're overwhelmed with His goodness. But reality of it is, if you've not been living in the flow of heaven and you've allowed things, wrong things, to dominate your thinking, dominate your life, it's going to be a struggle. And you're going to have to understand that there is an authority over your life that's keeping you from moving forward with God. And the Lord wants to break that off of you so that you can be strong in faith, that you can stand up against whatever you're facing and be victorious. Be more than a conqueror.
Yes. Yes.
You have authority. God has given you power and authority to cast out every devil, to deal with every sickness and disease, to heal all sicknesses and diseases.
Amen.
Well, let me just ask you this. Have you been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire?
Yes.
Well, if you have, then you've been given authority to cast out all devils and to heal all sickness and diseases. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, then no, you don't necessarily have authority over unclean spirits, over demons, and over all sicknesses and diseases. However, you still have the Spirit of the Lord residing on the inside of you that should result in the fruits of the Spirit and the life of God being revealed. Let me just say this to you once again, because I want you to appropriate it tonight. I want it to be appropriated in your life. I want you to do it. I want it to be a practical response in your life tonight. When you ask the Lord for an increase in the anointing, you're asking the Lord then that the life of Jesus and the power of Jesus would be revealed through you. That's what you're asking Him for. I say, I want an increase in the anointing. Lord, give me an increase in the anointing. Then you're saying, Lord, I want the life, which is His nature, His character, His power, the life and His power, life of Jesus and the power of Christ Jesus to be revealed through me. Now, what's going to result in that happening? How are you going to do that? What is it going to result in? How are you going to have an increase in anointing? How are you going to have an increase in anointing? Huh? How are you going to have an increase in anointing? Huh? Huh? Recognize that he's here, that he is, and that he's here. Because otherwise you're going to look to yourself and get in all your struggles and issues. It didn't take Cornelius' house long to get everything. It was one sermon.
Right.
Acts chapter 10, they got it all in one sermon. And it was like about a 5-minute sermon. It didn't seem very long. Hello. The disciples stepped into this inside of 3 years. Hello. 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 When is this work going to be done? See, everybody wants God to come and do something that he's already done. No, it ain't going to happen that way. God's already come and established it. He's already supplied it. You have to agree with it. There's got to be some participation on your part. It isn't something God's left you out. You've been left out. You're just left out. I tried. I did. I've done. I've been left out. No. You need to receive it now. You can receive these things right now. And I'm looking at you. I see those who know how to receive now. Because you could feel. See, you know what went out when I said that? You know what went out? What happened? There was an anointing released so that you could recognize just how easy it is to step into these things.
Hallelujah.
The anointing went out just so you could recognize how easy it is to have this. I feel like this all day. When I text somebody healed in Jesus' name, I feel this, what you're feeling right now, this anointing. I feel it. I feel the anointing come on me. I'm just agreeing with God. Anytime you agree with God, his word is going to work. At first, you may not have the ability to sense it, to, as it were, feel it. But as you give yourself to agreeing with God's word and standing in his word and not having it any different way, people, I've gone through the battles. I've gone through the struggle. Once again, I want you to get this. You tell Satan by the word of the Lord what he's going to do, and he'll push back at you. Huh? He'll go, oh, yeah? Huh? With circumstances, with feelings, with emotions. Sometimes you're going to have to get up in your place in God and start throwing some authority around in a serious
Amen.
Manner.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And say, I'm not backing down of here. I'm not backing. You out of here. I'm telling you right now. You out of here. You sorrow, you sadness. Satan is a rebellious imp. Not a single person on the planet is a match for him. But he cannot stand for one moment in the face of the greater one on the inside of you. Cannot stand for one moment. And the spirit that raised Christ from the dead that dwells in you quickens your mortal body.
Amen.
Huh? So that then you mortify or you put to death everything that comes against your body that's not allowed to be there. That's Romans. What was that one? That one's Romans 8:13. Huh? You put to death everything. You put it to death. You kill it. It's not the behavior of the Savior. Kill it.
Amen.
You have no right pain to be in my body.
Yes.
You have no right affliction to be in my body. You have no right sorrow or sadness to be in my body, to be in my being, to be in my emotions. My emotions are flooded with rivers of joy. How can any I'm almost taken? My emotions are flooded with rivers of joy. Hallelujah. And so now I get to build up myself. I get to strengthen myself praying in the Holy Ghost. praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping myself in the love of God. With all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Huh? With watching thereunto. Watching for what? Huh? Watching for anything that's going to come and try to do anything contrary to the Word of God against me or in my life or around me. Watching thereunto. Huh? With what? Thanksgiving. If I was some of you, I'd pray a lot louder in the Holy Ghost because you don't look that good. Look a little sick. Look a little peaked. Hey, you look a little peaked. Over there. Hey, you look a little lovable sabrama nakasa. Manega, that's a bogare. Manega lust. Stay by regana naya pasa. Mamada la ke beste brevata. Mayada la bogojia. Mandam radaya. Mandayan and Mayan Jesu, ya. Mayan and Jayara nayaso zaya. Mayara mayado shaya magahaya. Mandanaya, Jeba Yoro Mambakaha. Maya Jekiri Mama Soto Yosus. Braba Babarazia. Baraba Baba Baba Yajia. And if you haven't been baptized in the Holy Ghost, you can just go, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Oh, God, come fill me. Oh, God, come strengthen me. Hallelujah. Things of that nature. And we'll get you baptized in the Holy Ghost before the meeting's over. Hallelujah. People, this is the way it's done. You're not going to step into the power of the Holy Ghost unless you cooperate with what the Holy Ghost has given. You're not going to be able to sit there in the realms of yourself and have what God's afforded you. You've got to say to the self realm, the things of the influences of the circumstances and situations are too big for you to handle, the self realm. No, I'm not doing that. I'm not going with that. I'm not having that. I'm going to confront it. I'm going to tell you right now, tonight, I'm in the mood of confronting the thing so that you know how to have a practical application. And if you don't know how to pray in the Holy Ghost yet, you can just start getting happy. Hallelujah. Because what? That's cooperating with the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, if I want to learn how to yield with the Holy Spirit, I want to learn how to cooperate with Him. Because the more I cooperate with Him, the more I'm going to yield to Him. Then all you got to know is what He's doing. What is He doing? Joy. What is He doing? Righteousness. What is He doing? Peace. Hallelujah. How am I going to have peace when worry and concern is on me? That is an oppressive evil spirit that you've allowed because you agreed with something. You agreed with something that was from a realm of doubt and unbelief, from the realm of this world, from the realm of darkness. And you need somebody like me to grab a hold of you, say, hey, what's going on here? Huh? You can't run wild. You can't run around saying, I'm going to do it my own way. Look, it's playtime. No, playtime's over. Playtime is over. It's time to get serious. It's time to recognize that you are, whether you want to be or not, at war. Can I get the war? Have I got the war to find for you tonight? Is it spoken into your spirit? Have I got it past your head? Because your head's not big enough to wrap around the reality of what I'm talking about. Have I got it into your spirit to recognize that you at war, that there is a conflict where Satan and the spirit of this world is trying to impose upon you everything that is opposite of God, because Satan, the Antichrist spirit, the spirit of this world, hates everything that belongs to the expressions of God, hates everything that looks like the image of God in you and me, and his purpose to drive the image of God as far away with sin and iniquity as he can. With sorrow and oppression and depression and sickness and disease and corruption. Somebody's going to have to stand up and take hold of this. Somebody's going to have to start following the leader. Listen, I do not believe that anyone should ever be conformed to the image of man or submit to the will of man. I don't believe that. I believe that every single person is supposed to be conformed to the image of Christ and submit to the will of God. And that you then could follow me as I follow Christ. As I declare these things of the word of God to you and declare to you your glorious liberty. That if you'll walk in this joy, if you'll walk in this peace, that the mountains and the hills will break forth into singing. That an outpouring of God's power and glory and grace will be revealed on your life. And then in your life and through your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Mambonda sekeri. Haripa karu manjesi. Hirivaro satori sikande. Marenda nadaveste kana moshia. Ande hanesena. Hande in the sting the basatai. Hande in the sting the bananeasa. Hambre de kana lo boshiki. Hambre de kara bashele di dikita. Mendendele. Ambrosio. Halavakase. You know what this does? You know what this does? This prepares you for the battle. This prepares you unto every good work to where you can confront Satan and you can say, leave now. And he obeys.
Amen.
Because you said to him when he brought his sorrow, leave. I'm not participating with you. And you turned right towards Christ Jesus, and you look to the author and finisher of your faith. You let God lead you to the rock that is higher than you. When your heart is overwhelmed, what do? Let the lead me to the rock which is higher than me. What is he going to do? Water's going to come out of the rock. You're going to take a drink, and when you take a drink of the water Jesus gives you, a river's going to start flooding through you. This wonderful, blessed privilege that we have to walk out this relationship with the Father. To look into the author and finisher of our faith. To learn how to live an entirely different life, with an entirely different disposition and nature, all by the Holy Ghost showing us, teaching us how to live out the life of Jesus. Ooh. Wow. You mean we could do this? Yeah. Yeah. All the resources, all the divine power has been given so that we can do this. Well, listen. I know one of the things that God needs, because I'm telling you, I feel revival. I feel a great outpouring of God's power in the atmosphere. It's going to happen. But I'm just looking for some people to cooperate with God. You're going to have to adjust the expression on your face. You're going to have to adjust, hallelujah, the feelings and the emotions of your spirit. And let them be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus by cooperating with what God the Holy Ghost is doing. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering. Here's what God wants to do. The Lord wants to develop in people's lives who give themselves to these realms of the Spirit, to give themselves to these things of the Holy Ghost, compassion.
Yes.
And it's just rare. It is rare. I rarely see the compassion of the Holy Ghost. You see a lot of sympathy and empathy. And we can even see the manifest love of Jesus in people. But compassion, that's deep. That's deep. People become hard. And when you have to deal with this thing and this offense and that offense and this person did you wrong and that person did you wrong and you've had this hurt and this problem, you become hard. And you begin to almost like protect yourself. It's like the person who's always seeing death. They become callous to death. It's like a person always seeing people suffering. They become calloused at suffering. Huh? They become hard. Oh, well, it can work the other way. It can create greater compassion to where you won't agree with death anymore. You start raising people from the dead. Huh? It becomes uzarababa. It becomes deep compassion where you don't agree with suffering anymore and you deliver people out of their sickness and their disease and their affliction. Hallelujah.
Yes. Hallelujah.
If I can be used of the Lord to help you tonight. to understand the things that are directly coming at you, the condemnation that's coming at you, the shame, the guilt that's coming at you, the worry, the concern that's coming at you, your heart being overwhelmed. If I can help you understand specifically what you're having to go through, and then help you to know how to cast your care upon Him, to say, I trust you, Father. I'm not, I thank you for showing me that my emotions are all wrapped up in that thing. I didn't know my emotions were so wrapped up in it. Somebody scratched up my back bumper, and I've been sad all day. That is really something terrible to really have your emotions all wrapped up in. I mean, you just should let that thing go. Huh? I mean, why pray when you can worry? It needs to be turned around. It needs to be turned around. And find a way to where you don't worry anymore. Even if they told you that we're going to come and burn your house down. You know, I'm so blessed with my wife because they told us they were killing us. They would definitely kill us. Anne never flinched. She never flinched. She never one time said to me, but honey, I really want to be around for the grandbabies. Honey, you mean this could be it? I mean, I really want to watch the kids come into their families. She never one time flinched. She never one time flinched. I got myself a good partner. Never one time did she flinch. When the mammoths told us, we will kill you. We're killing everybody that comes with you. You're dead. When we wrote out her will, she never flinched. When we got the insurance policy, she never flinched. She was smiling, happy all the time. Hallelujah. Hooked up with the purposes of God. To when you begin to understand how much He loves you, how that He never leave you nor forsake you, how He upholds you, how He's El Shaddai and He's your benefactor. How He's on your side, how He takes your part. Then it's easy to trust Him. You don't have to figure you got to trust yourself. You can't trust yourself and trust God at the same time. It don't work. It won't work. And as soon as you start trusting yourself, you're going to be afraid. Now you just got to identify self. As soon as you start trusting yourself, you're going to be stressed out. Now you just got to identify self. As soon as you start trusting yourself, you're going to start fighting with men instead of fighting with the devil. Fighting with the powers of darkness. Helped you understand you trust in yourself. When you trust God, everything's fine. You're good. I'm good. How you doing? I'm blessed with all spiritual blessing in the heavenly realm. Hallelujah. God is on my side. He should take my part. He set me in a large, large place. Hallelujah. He upholds me so that I don't even stub my toe. Listen, I want to walk in that realm. I want to walk in the realm to where He upholds me, where I don't even dash my foot against the stone. But that's coming to a place where you and I are willing to agree with the ministry of the Lord Jesus. I do nothing of myself. As I see the Father do it, that's what I do. As I hear the Father say it, that's what I speak. That's the Word. That's the Bible. That's the Word of God. That's how we get equipped. You're going to have to start living by the Word. You're going to have to start living by the Word. If I could get everybody in this place to go and photocopy Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 6, and Matthew chapter 7, and commit yourself to living that every day, the first thing that's going to happen is you're going to recognize how much you need to be filled with the Holy Ghost and how much you need to depend upon the Holy Ghost. That's the first thing that's going to happen. But you know what? You need to come to grips with reality. Because He will give you the power and the ability to do it. And that's what God demands. That's what He requires. And within a year, your whole life would be different. Why? Because you would have cooperated with the Holy Ghost on a consistent enough basis to have the thing defined and decided before all heaven and earth that you're yielded to the Holy Ghost. He's your master and your sovereign God, and you're submitted to Him. What goes on with people's lives, it's a roller coaster. Today I'm in charge. No, today God's in charge. That's the top part. Okay? Yesterday God was in charge. That was top part. Today I'm in charge. That's the bottom part. Next day God's in charge. Next day you're in charge. And it's just a roller coaster life. I've got to make this practical for you. I've got to get you over in heaven. I've got to get you to a place that you're living out a life that you want to die and go to. Because that's the life that the Father has for you. He wants you to start living the heavenly life. He starts living the Jesus life. Come on, every one of you, God has given, the Lord has not withheld the Holy Spirit from any single person in this place. He's not withheld any of His goodness from any single person in this place. Amen. You and I have to decide that wrong behavior is not allowed in our lives anymore. Yeah. That wrong attitudes are not allowed in our lives anymore. That wrong decisions are not allowed in our lives anymore. Yeah. You got to decide it. I want to bring you to a decision. I could have said what I've said here tonight in 30 minutes. I am pleading with you by the Holy Ghost to bring you to a decision. I'm throwing the spotlight of the Word of God upon your soul, and it's beaming you. It's blinding some of you. Spotlight. And if you look into yourself, you're going to get real sad. Or you're going to get mad. But we want you to get glad and say, oh, I don't have to look at myself. God. Hallelujah. It is God who gives me the ability. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's God who has empowered me. He causes me to triumph over all of my enemies. Hallelujah. 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 Father, I ask you to cause this to burn within the heart and the spirit of every person in this place, that they can truly understand what it means to deny themselves. Hallelujah. That they can truly tomorrow, when they begin to deal with these issues and self is ready to take charge of the program, they go, I got it. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for wisdom and insight. I'm not going that direction. I'm not going to get overwhelmed. You know, for me, I have what would call triggers. Things that I just do. I let that be the trigger to turn on my heart, my senses, and my thinking right over to God. You know, there are many times, you know, that I get reports of where, you know, we, you know, have a $30,000 deficit, or, you know, have different things like that. There's not this or there's not that. You know, because when you're doing a lot of different things financially, you can get. And of course, there's nothing probably affect people more than finances. You know what I do? Honey, what do I do? What do I do? What do I say? Just say, let's watch and see what God will do. I don't take it personally. I said, let's just watch and see what God will do. And I'm done. I don't think another thing about it. Huh? Because that's followed, let's watch and see what God will do. That's followed by Tastaveta Nikidi Palananamas. I love you, Lord. Praise your holy name. I just pray in the Holy Ghost till I can't remember what was wrong. I pray in the Holy Ghost till I can't remember what the problem was. What was the problem? That's what I tell you. I pray in the Holy Ghost till the peace comes. I pray in the Holy Ghost till the strength comes. I pray in the Holy Ghost till the joy comes. I pray in the Holy Ghost till the prophecy comes. When you get in your car and you're on your way to the church, you shouldn't be sitting here listening to CNN. And S-I-N, and B-A-D, you should be listening to that, You should start praying in the Holy Ghost before you ever leave the house. When you start getting dressed and putting your clothes on to come to the meeting, you should start praying in the Holy Ghost. If you're going to be serious with God and participate with Him, you're going to understand how to look to God and yield your members to Him. And submit yourself to His ability that He gives. And because you're living, if you're not careful, what's going to happen until you do this, all you're doing is you're living out your life out of the realms of your human ability. If you're women, you're cooking, you're doing the dishes, you're doing laundry, you're cleaning the house, you're doing your other stuff, you're going to work maybe as well. If you're men, maybe, you know, the classification of the things you're doing, you're caught away with your job and your issues and your lawn, you know. And your rims on your tires, or whatever it is that you do. Well, where is it that you're going to begin to completely find yourself completely given over to the Holy Ghost? Well, what happens? What is the transition that you look at people and you know what they're going through? anybody, just walking down the street, walking the store. You walk in the store, and the store isn't about going and getting food only. The store is about divine appointments, that everywhere I go, I've got a divine appointment. And I'm looking for the divine appointment. And Father's going to bring it together where it's just so perfect. I'm not going to talk about the weather. I'm not going to talk about what happened down the street yesterday. But I'm living in a And out of that, there's an opportunity. There's going to be some kind of an opportunity that the Lord, everywhere we go, God will give me. Amen. There ain't nobody sits down with me on a flight. God put him there. Amen. Oh, well, no, it's just coincidental. You're in a self realm. You're in a natural realm, not a spiritual realm. You're in a place where you're in charge or something else is in charge. Blow on the dice, throw it. I don't live in that realm. I don't look on those things which are seen, but on those things which are unseen. I don't live in a temporal, I live in an eternal. I live, but every one of my steps being ordered by the Lord. Hello. Because I'm telling you, right now, you and I are responsible for everybody we talk to. We're responsible for everybody we run into. And what's happened is self-realm will overwhelm you, and you want them to like you. So you're going to try to do everything you possibly do and say to get them to like you, that when they're not going to like you. They might smile at you, but they're not really going to like you because they're all caught up in the spirit of the world, which is hate and envy and division. Huh? And you had an opportunity to get them to like God. To get them to receive the love of God. And if you begin to live that way, at first it's going to be awkward. At first you're not going to know what to do. You won't even be able to open your mouth. You'll be overwhelmed by self. Self is... I don't know what to say. Yep, you don't. And if you say something that sounds really awkward... Hey, did you try Jesus? Hey, did you ever go to church ever in your life? Awkward. Now, Father wants to come and give us the ability to say, Father knows what you're going through. He understands what's happening in your life. He just wants you to know that you love him. Amen. He just wanted to tell me about you. You're going to have to get yourself over in the place of hooked up with Holy Ghost there. That's why he gave us the ability. He gave us a supernatural ability to begin to flow in the masita rabekanda la mamasa rebebetia that would bring us to the word of knowledge, to the word of wisdom. To be able to speak to someone a word of wisdom changes their whole life. To speak a word of knowledge, you saw Nathaniel. And he said, I saw you there. You know, Nathaniel's not a believer. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Huh? I saw you there underneath the fig tree. My Lord and my God. See, there's a word of knowledge to open up to every person's heart. But you and I are going to have to get over into a place of not living out ourselves and doing it for ourselves and wanting people to like us and wanting people to think that we're smart and wanting people to think that we look good or whatever else we try to do. You know, to make it presentable. You listen to me.
Yes.
You and I, we ambassadors of the King.
Amen.
Yeah. We're supposed to be people of the Spirit. Yeah. We're supposed to be people of heaven. We're supposed to be the light of the world, the salt of the earth. We're supposed to be people living in the Spirit and walking in the Spirit, just like Jesus did. He said, come and follow me.
Yes.
Now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I deal with every sickness and disease and every affliction of the mind and every torment of the mind.
Thank you, Lord.
And I want everybody in this place to recognize, not only is it broken, not only do I smash it in the name of Jesus, but God's demanding of you to stop it. God's demanding of you to shut the power plant down.
Amen.
Blow it up. Blow up the source of all that stuff. Blow it up. I want everybody to stand with me. Just stand with me. The presence of the Lord is here. Hallelujah. Jesus is here. Jesus is here. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Jesus. Jesus is here. Jesus is here. The idea that you're on your own, that God's not listening, that he doesn't notice you, that he doesn't like you, that he's got something against you. All lies. You got to shut that down. You know what that is? That is listening to the Antichrist spirit. The greater one on the inside of you says, no, don't listen to this. That is lies. You're not going to know it's lies unless you know the Word of God. The Word of God is truth. Everything that is not the Word of God is a lie. You're going to have to start walking in the truth. Did anybody ever read that verse of Scripture? Those verses. Hallelujah. 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 Harene mendeya brusande. Harene mondastate apakalaya. Halalambo rabasateya. Hallelujah. Remanda sekine in emenda. Halamonza sevrete. Halamangala sitivrite. Hallelujah. Narama manganda sazivrite. Ha ha ha. Balandare bekede de besse vitayo. Harabari nene mengeya. Harabandere ne mengeri nasheya tufasi. Harremanda dalala mangeya shalamatufa vetishi. Ha ha. Mandendina. Mandendina mana. Mandendina mana nasheya tuf. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Harama mamanda de dea frateka siada. Hallelujah. Ha ha ha. Hallelujah. Che brama monsando le leveche, si ben brevecando la bossata, vieri ve sete de decere, sciano de mandala se. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, go ahead and get baptized right now. Let the glory of heaven flow out of your innermost being right now in Jesus' name. Bacarama manjeri sarananda leia monakai, hana manja serenea. We stand up tonight against every power of darkness, every afflicting, tormenting thing, every power of hell that would try to stop this ministry and try to stop the people in this ministry. We stand up against it tonight in the name of the Most High God. We come not with sword nor shield, but in the name of Jesus Christ. Satan, you have no right to afflict. You have no right to torment. You have no right to hold back that which God's ordained. Father, we thank you that those who are standing in this place will be strengthened by the Spirit and begin to rise up to the authority and the faith that you have given so that this nation can be healed, that this region can receive a great outpouring of your power and of your glory. Sotaraman Maseya. Kirimando lobo sotefriti. Dear people, if you will not walk in Holy Ghost conviction, then no Holy Ghost conviction will ever work through you. Somebody says, how do I walk in Holy Ghost conviction? You just simply don't allow things in your life that aren't pleasing unto the Lord. And the more you give yourself to that, the stronger Holy Ghost conviction is in your life. Hallelujah. See, the realms of the Holy Ghost brings with it the beautiful things that the Holy Ghost brings. He brings wisdom and understanding. That's just all in the package. Counsel and might. Whoa. That's how I can be strong in those strength of the Lord and power of his might. Knowledge and the fear of the Lord. Oh, rabba baba sedeke di tapana. Oh, rabba mama mama naste. Now, I want you to grab a hold of the reality that you need to lay hold on the things that belong to that which is of the Spirit, that which is of the Holy Ghost. God says you're not in the natural life anymore. You're not in the realms of human ability. You're not in the flesh anymore. When will you hear? When will you listen? God says, when will you listen to what he said and begin to now participate with it? But you in the Holy Ghost. You in a realm called spiritual. You in a realm called heavenly. Your mind's supposed to be set upon the things that belong to a realm called heavenly. Not your houses, not your clothes, not your business, not what you have with respect to natural things and possessions and your vacations and your ideas for yourself. New bathtub. Ring's getting a little tarnished. You need a new one. I would hate to stand before him and say, you labor more over the things of yourself than you did over the things of heaven. You lived in the flesh. You had a good doctrine, but you lived in the flesh. I believe the people that know the Word of God have a greater responsibility. I'm telling you right now, there may be people that don't know as much as you and make heaven because you know what you know, you won't. You listen to me. The greater the response, the greater the things that you know. God gives us the possibility of walking in a greater dimension of his anointing through the knowledge of the Lord. But if you receive the knowledge of the Lord and don't do anything with it, you are in jeopardy. To have the grace of God bestowed upon you and you don't do anything with it. People, it's about time you understand. God told you to not covet a new boat, covet a new job, covet a new whatever. He told you to covet the spiritual. He told you to covet the realms of heavenly. The heavenly. And you know what? If we covet it, he sees whether we're coveting it or not. And when we covet it, he's going to get it to us. When we can just live without it, we're not coveting it, we're not passionate, we're not desperate. The Lord knows the tears I've cried and the prayers I've pled. Oh God, that I may touch heaven, that I may touch this realm. I'm going to tell you right now, he knows the tears you've cried about yourself or whether it's about, Lord, I want the things of the Spirit. I want the things of the supernatural. Or just sitting around crying about somebody didn't do you right, somebody don't understand you, they're not tender or gentle enough with you. Hello? Oh, my mom, Zacchaeus. The bottom line is I just prayed God for the abiding place. The church of the Lord Jesus Christ is here. You know, I get in places where, you know, I've only got two nights or one night or two nights or three nights talking to people. Man, I praise God for the things that he gets done. But I recognize what it takes. You've got to labor with these things with folks because people are so distracted with the cares of this life. But the word of God is so powerful, it'll work effectually in you. If you allow good ground of your life, it'll produce the fruit of God overnight, as it were. There's, you know what the adjustments are you got to make? You got to make the adjustment of being happy all day. Those are some tough adjustments. You got to make the adjustments of being thankful. You got to make the adjustments of recognizing and acknowledging God and saying, wait a minute, they had a glory cloud. I got the Holy Ghost. Oh, sitana mia. Father wants you to get bold. He wants you to get bold. Like Luke chapter 11, he wants you to get bold and start saying, this way we got to do it. This way it needs to come down. Father, I must have a greater manifestation of your life and power through my life. Father, I must have the wisdom and the insight to know how to cooperate with the Holy Ghost and quit yielding my members to things that are opposite, antichrist, opposite, sorrow, sadness, complaint, murmuring, all the rest of that mess that will work death and disease in your bones. Hallelujah. I want all of you tonight to agree with me. I want you to rise up and stand up against sickness and disease. I want you to rise up and stand up in your spirit against the things that Satan would try to do to stop the flow of the anointing, to stop the move of God. Yeah, you know what? You're going to go through a fiery, you're going to go through a fiery furnace of faith. Just stand there praising God. Just submit yourself to God. Just submit yourself to his word. Just do what's right. Do what God says to do. Don't be unwilling. Do not be unwilling. Do not stand there with your mouth closed, ever. But lift up your voice. Say, evening and morning and at noon will I pray. And then not only will I pray, I will cry aloud. Not only will I pray and cry aloud, but you will hear my voice. That's called boldness. That's called confidence with God. That's called trust. That's called elpis. That's called batah. You will hear my voice. I know who you are. I know what expense that you went through to get me, to redeem me. I know what you demand of my soul. I know that you want me to have this in my spirit, that I want you more than anything on this planet. That I demand, my soul demands the things of God. That I'm no longer wondering about my status in God and my identity in him. But I know whom I have believed in. I know he dwells on the inside of me. I know that his power is at work within me. And I know the authorities of hell and the spirit of the world that comes against me and tries to impose its will. See, God will not impose his will, but Satan will. You're going to have to know where the battle lines are, otherwise you'll never succeed. You're going to have to recognize whether you've been trusting in yourself or trusting in God, otherwise you'll never know how to move in the Holy Ghost. You've got to be able to identify it. And God has given you the spirit of wisdom, And I'm telling you, I ask for the spirit of wisdom every day. I ask God for wisdom every day. I had yesterday's wisdom. I need today's wisdom. Today I had today's wisdom. Tomorrow I'm going to need tomorrow's wisdom. I'm there, right there at the foot, hallelujah, of the cross. I'm right there at the foot of the throne. I'm right there standing before the presence of the Lord, receiving every day that which now God has given me to live out His life. With total dependence upon Him, for without Him I can do nothing. I make sure every day I'm, as a branch, am hooked up clearly with the vine, and I'm depending upon the sap, the Holy Ghost, to bring forth the life of my being, the fruit of my soul and of my spirit. People, it is something that you got to open up your mouth to do. It is, listen, I understand when you've lived in the self realm so long and your self realm has had so much dominance over you, it is very difficult for you to change your behavior and start praising God three times a day. Anything, just changing anything to accommodate, modeling yourself after the people of the Word of God, after the things of the Word of God. But if you'll just realize that the power of God is right there, that the Holy Ghost is right there, and you say to Him, Lord, I want to be reminded. I want to understand how to come before You three times a day. I want to understand how to step into a new way. I want to understand how to walk in a new realm. I want to understand how to take a hold of this higher ground of Your Word and begin to live in it and live by it. I'm telling you, He will do it. He will do it. Now, He who has begun a good work in you shall perfect it. He shall bring it to pass. He shall complete it by Christ Jesus. Because you want it desperately. Because you want it. Because you need it. Because you can't live without it. Because you're hungry. See, some people read that verse of Scripture and forget everything else they've read. Oh, God has begun a good work in me. He's going to do it. I'm just going to go doing whatever I want to do. No. God has begun a good work in you. We'll complete it because you're hungry and thirsting for the kingdom of God. Because you're hungry and thirsting after righteousness. Because you're seeking first the kingdom of God. Just remember, anything you can live without, you're not hungry for. Hungry is something you've got to have because you can't live without it. Thirsty is something you've got to have because you can't live without it. I'm commanding you to change tonight. I'm commanding you to get out of your behavior. Somebody said, well, I'm just quiet by nature. I want you to get rid of that. And you need to get loud like God gets loud. Somebody said, well, you know, I'm just kind of introverted by nature. No, you confessing that you've not gotten God's nature. You've not been born of the Spirit. What's coming out of your mouth is what you really believe in your heart. You need to stop believing that kind of stuff and get God's Word abiding in your heart. Hallelujah. And recognize that you've received the divine nature. God wants you to understand that how simple it is to put on the new man, to put on the Lord Jesus like a cloak. But it demands a hunger. It demands something that you can't live without. I can't live without you today. I can't live without that. On vacation, when I'm sleeping, that's what vacation to me means. I get to sleep all day. Ann and I went, tried to get a little break, and we went out to this beautiful place, this beautiful island, right off the shores of Seattle, right there in Washington, you know, out in the Puget Sound. You know what we did? Went to bed and slept. Ann says, that's too personal to tell. But even just sleeping. I mean, that's vacation. We, you know, when you run wide open, you want to just get some rest, finally. Plus, halabatakuya. And you know what I do? And this might help you, too. You know what I do? I put responsibilities in the kingdom of God upon myself. So I had a responsibility to get up, even though I was so wiped out, at 1 o'clock and do a face stream. And so when I kind of started coming to around 10 o'clock, and we didn't go to bed late either. We just said, our body said, we are going to sleep. We do not have to do anything. So when we got into that, we went into a coma. I open my eyes at like 10 o'clock and I just like, I can't get up. I'm in a coma. And I'm sitting there, laying there thinking, oh Lord, I'm going to represent you. I'm speaking on your behalf. Oh, Holy Spirit, I can't do anything without you. Come strengthen me. Come fill me. Now, if I don't hook up with the means and the authority that he's given, then I'm losing out. So I begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Because I know what's going to happen. My spirit is going to be totally yielded to the Holy Ghost there. And I'm going to know what he wants me to say. Hallelujah. And I'm halabasifreteya. And I'm going to speak it out of the realms of prophecy, doctrine, good doctrine, Holy Ghost doctrine. So just put some things on yourself. 7 o'clock, I go to prayer. I'm telling you these things that so that you can follow. Does that mean that's the first time I prayed all day? No. That's just the time I've set apart. Do I always pray an hour? No. But it's an hour time of prayer. May go over, may go under. Hallelujah. Just put some responsibilities on yourself. I get up in the morning. You know what's my priority? Bible reading. How many times have I read it? Many. Hundreds. I mean, I've read it so much that I've translated it already. And then come back. Huh? I mean, it'd be harder than if you were to, it'd be like this. It'd be like you taking and not only writing out by hand all the scriptures of the Bible, but looking up all the words and defining them as you go. But I still go back and I'm going, oh, look at that. Huh? Because the Holy Ghost opens up my eyes to behold wondrous things out of his law. So I sit down and I go, I'm ready to have some communion with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. That's first. It's first. Put some things on yourself. So put some requirements on yourself. Put some requirements on reaching the lost, because that's what the Lord has given you, a requirement. Put a requirement on you. I'm required to reach the lost. I'm required to bring them into the house of God. I'm required to go and see people changed, they that believe and are baptized. You may have to talk to 1,000 people before you get one. I don't think you will. I like to interview those of you who talked to 1,000 people under the anointing and haven't gotten one yet. Put these things on you, on yourself. But don't look to yourself. If you look to yourself, you're going to get all overwhelmed. I can't do it. I don't know how to talk. Moses, I don't know how to talk. Are you standing in front of God? I don't know how to talk. So, you know, the Lord just like, okay, whatever. Aaron will talk for you. I mean, come on. I made the tongue. You know? I'm the one who formed your mouth. I'm the one who gave you life. Don't you think I can help you speak? But, you know, he didn't have the Holy Ghost yet, so he couldn't understand. Can you hear me? It's kind of funny, but it's true. The Lord said, I have many things to say to you, but you can't understand them. But when the Holy Ghost comes, you'll get it. Tonight, maybe some of you don't really know how to move with the Holy Ghost. Get hungry for him. He's real. He's God. He's real. One day, your eyes are going to see him. One day, your eyes are going to see him. In the not too distant future. I was talking to a man of God the other day, 80 years old, and he's going to come out here. He looks good. 80 years old, he looks young. He said, yeah, the Lord told me I'm going to live to 120. When he was a young man, the Lord told him he was going to live to his 120. Full of the word. Oh, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful man. Just immediately, family, you know, as soon as I saw him, family. Pretty beautiful, ain't it? I'm talking to you about the things that are, there's so much there. You can lay hold of it. So many opportunities in the kingdom. So many good gifts. So many, every spiritual blessing you can think of is yours. We just neglect them. We don't understand how to lay hold on them. And I want to show you, this is what this is, this night is tonight, is about grabbing you and saying, look, you really can have this. You can really do this. All you got to do is begin to understand what you're submitting yourself to and stop submitting yourself to the wrong stuff. there's anybody in your life that you haven't forgiven, you get them. You get love for them right now, and you get it forgiven. If there's anybody you talk bad about, you stop. You need to repent. You have defiled yourself. You stop it. I was talking to Raj on the phone last night. He called me up, talked to me a while. He's such a blessing to me, such a dear friend, such a wonderful man of God. Roger Teal. You know, and he said, you know, he was just commenting. He said, yeah, you know, when we don't talk bad about people, because we were talking about some things. He said, yeah, you're right, you know. When we don't talk bad about people, we don't have anywhere near the same level of problem. We find a whole nother realm of living in God when we get past our bad attitudes and all of our commentary that runs everybody down or anyone down or in any way cast a bad light on another person. We curse ourselves. And then wondering why we're not able to grab a hold of the blessing. Stop that nonsense. I've told people over and again, I got an easy remedy for it. It's a vow of silence, and we can help you with a vow of silence. They got this stuff called gorilla tape. A couple wraps around your head. Amen. Hallelujah. You're shut down. Probably 90% of your problems cured. Could I convince you of it? Hallelujah. I'm not kidding you. I wish you could put some duct tape around your mind, but I can't do that. But mouth, 90%. 90%. 90%. Yes. 90.
Amen.
Say, Lord, put a watch on my mouth.
Keep the door of my lips.
So that there would be no utterance of deceit, no utterance of evil speaking. Come, children, hearken unto me, and I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Who would like to live a long life and see many good days with the peace of God in them? Keep your tongue from evil, and that you let speak no deceit. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Come on, because all that other stuff, that realm, it's not a demonic realm of some evil nature. It's that you went over into a realm of self, and out of that, somehow you hook up with some hurt. Now that becomes a demonic empowerment. You hear me?
Yes.
You hook up with some hurt or some unforgiveness or some malice or some strife. That is a demonic power. It is a demonic power that you did what? Yielded your members to. It wasn't raining on the inside of you, because sin doesn't rain anymore. You yielded your members to it. You didn't interface with it, with the greater one that's on the inside, dealing with the wickedness on the outside. You yielded to it through the self realm. Can you hear me?
Yes.
If I can show you this, if I can get and impart this wisdom into you by the Spirit of the Lord, if you'll grab a hold of what I'm telling you tonight, I promise you, God will show you how to live this out in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody, do me a favor. Lift your hands towards heaven. Let the Spirit of the Lord touch you and strengthen you right now. Let Him give you every good hope and every good confidence and every good faith and every good thing. Hallelujah. All of it. Walk in His joy, walk in His love, walk in His peace, walk in divine ability, be encouraged. Don't set your things on possessions. Don't set your things on having stuff in this life. Set your affections on things above. Listen, I want to remind you that we have pledge cards outside, and the pledge cards are for the church building that we're putting up on the MTC this year. And we're right at about $18,000. We have to raise $60,000. So I just want you to step out in the realm of faith and just believe God. for the things that he's going to do through our lives. The Lord is showing me some things, unveiling some things to me about church planting that is unique. And that really has to do with, you need to get a hold of her. She's not in charge. And that's really, it's really about getting hooked up with all these various churches out there that are already going, already have good people in it, but they need help. And they need more, they just need more, they just need people come alongside of them. And so, kind of same thing that we're doing with orphanages, not trying to start new orphanages, but just taking the ones that are there and making them better and making them more sustainable. And so, I mean, we just need all of you guys to just, in every area of your life, just begin to pray, cry out to God, bring these petitions before the Lord every day. And as you do, the Spirit of the Lord will begin to speak through you. Listen to me. It will be more than a request. He will begin to cause that prayer to excel into you speaking forth faith. Amen. In the gift of faith. It's a beautiful thing. But if you don't do it, if you don't give yourself to the prayer of it, you're never going to learn how to speak faith. You start off speaking to the Father in a request and a petition, and the Spirit of the Lord takes it to another level in your life, and suddenly you're speaking out faith and calling things in. Right in that same context, you may have been praying, petitioning the prayer for, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 months. It won't be that way always, because you're going to find out as you grow and you get strengthened in this, you'll only petition prayer for a while with it, maybe 2-3 days at most, and then the gift of faith will come and you'll speak it out in faith. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Do you see the? Can you hear the practical application I'm giving you?
Yes.
I'm going to give you some more practical application this Friday night at the School of the Spirit. If you'll recognize that I'm giving you practical step one, step two, step three, step four to moving in these things, and you'll start doing them, you will profit from it. If you do not put it to practice in a practical way, you're not going to grow. And then you're going to have me looking at you 20 years from now saying, raise your hand, receive. 20 years from now. I mean, can you just imagine 20 years from now, you don't know how to move in the gift of faith any more than you do today. Don't even run the risk. Little prayer, little faith. Just understand that. Understand what's going to happen. That there's something greater going on than you just speaking out your request to the Lord. Speak out your request to the Lord. Make them known to the Lord. And the God of peace is going to take care of you. Hallelujah. You with me? He'll keep you. And he's going to answer those things that you ask for of him, because that's what his purpose is. But you grow in it. You grow and you mature in it by the doing of it. Huh? Hallelujah. When I brava siki antaranamana makistebrebebeteya. That sounds much different than what it sounded like when it first started in my life many years ago. Why is it what it is now? Because I gave myself to it. It matures. Everything in the things of the Spirit, as you give yourself to them, they'll grow and they'll mature. Do not allow bad attitudes to seethe in you. Disappointments, discouragement. If it's not the behavior of the Savior, you get it?
Yes.
Mortify therefore your deeds which are upon the earth. You get it?
Yes.
Cleanse yourself from all the filthiness of the flesh and the spirit. You get it?
Yes.
Don't allow yourself to commune with it, because you're righteousness, not unrighteousness. You're light, not darkness. You are Christ, not of Belial. You the temple of the Holy Ghost, not of idols. For God says, he lives in you, he dwells in you. Now, understand who you join to and who you're walking with. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord.